Despite being so abstract, though, I really believe that science can benefit from these branches of mathematics. In particular, science needs unification, and especially in fields like complex systems, where there's disparate approaches speaking about the same thing. Unification is fundamental to greater understanding. Emily's gonna talk today about the art of giving the same name to different things.
Great, thanks so much. Can the remote folks hear me okay? Is there any way to check that?
Sounds good.
Oh, wonderful, thanks so much. Great, so thank you, and thanks, Andres. I'm really excited to have the opportunity to be here. This is my first time at the Santa Fe Institute, and I'm very impressed. So I was instructed to give a very kind of general sort of talk, not so technical, on the mathematics. There's a sense in which this talk's going to be very philosophical, because what I'm going to tour are different perspectives that have evolved over the last century on sameness. So there's a sense in which all of what math is about, you know, famously Atiyah said mathematics is the science of analogy. It's the art. So we'll see, this is a quote of Henri Poincaré. It's the art of giving the same name to two different things. And so there's a sense that a lot of what mathematicians are in the business of doing are proving theorems that say, even though X and Y seem rather unrelated, there's a, you know, deep structural analogy between them. But mathematics also doesn't really speak in the language of metaphors. Mathematicians certainly speak in the language of metaphor, but mathematics itself is a bit more formal and a bit more precise. So what I'm going to tour are four technical terms in mathematics. So equality, isomorphism, equivalence, and identity. Though when I get there, I'll call it more identification. So these are four different technical meanings of the idea of sameness. And they're presented in this order, both because it's the historical order, and I think it really does represent some sort of progress in our thinking between, you know, what it means for two things to be considered the same. So, these are all precise technical terms in the mathematics. So I'm not, I'm gonna speak about them in a clearer way that's slightly less technical. But I'm hoping that this, I think these can be useful as metaphors as well. Sort of as analogies beyond just the discipline for which they were invented. I should say there's a lot of time in this talk for interruptions and discussion, and it's kind of more fun for me if that happens along the way rather than necessarily at the end. So please object at any time. So
kind of nice that there's a meta sameness among all these things.
You've given different names to all these things that are the same.
Yes, that's true. That hadn't occurred to me. So thank you for pointing that out. Wonderful. Okay, so let's go ahead and begin. So the traditional view of when two things are the same is equality, which is something that is formally defined in first order logic. And what first order logic is it's sort of the formal language in which mathematical statements and proofs are expressed. So I'm not going to sort of introduce first order logic, but first order logic is a it's a way to sort of look at a sentence and kind of recognize whether it is mathematically precise enough to have a definite truth value, true or false. Now, the business of deciding whether something is true or false, I mean, that's where proofs come in, but it's about kind of very clear logical expressions. So whenever mathematicians use a new term, we give it a precise definition, and that's kind of the point of agreement. So this is how equality is formally defined in mathematics. So firstly, the equal sign itself. So that's, written kind of right here in the middle. The equal sign itself is sort of a primitive binary relation. And what that means is that if you have any two mathematical things whatsoever, X and Y, you know, any things that exist in this sort of universe of all mathematical things, it's meaningful to ask whether they're equal. I mean, that might not be true, but it's sort of meaningful to ask the question. That's the meaning of a binary relation. And then what makes this relation the equality relation as opposed to some other relation is the following two axioms. So the first one is reflexivity. So anything is equal to itself. So I've written it formally in first order logic, but this says for all x, x is equal to x. For anything that exists, it's equal to itself. And then the second axiom is more subtle. It goes by the name indiscernibility of identicals, or identicality of indiscernibility, or, you know, so if you, I mean the same thing by both identity of indiscernibles and discernibility of identicals. But what it means is that two things are equal if and only if they have exactly the same properties. So the logical sentence, the sentence in first order logic that expresses that is here. So for any two things X, X and Y, X is equal to Y is true. So it is the case that X is equal to Y if and only if, for all properties or predicates, if you're familiar with the term P, P of X holds if and only if P of Y. So that's the formal way to read it. So this is a fairly complicated axiom, but it's a second order axiom because it's quantifying over all predicates and not, over all properties. What is a property? I mean, there is a mathematical definition of a property, but it's a little bit hard to think about. And this is it. This is the entire meaning of equality. Yes.
Naive question, but doesn't the first one follow from the second one?
I don't believe so. Because you could use the second one to prove that X is equal to X if you could show for all X, P of X holds if and only if P of X holds. I guess that's your reasoning.
Maybe because it's second order and
So I haven't gotten into the technical meaning of predicate. That's interesting to think about. I'm not entirely sure.
I would like to think that P of X, if and only if P of X.
So usually in the rules that would say what a predicate is, you would require invariance under substitution for equality. So really the interesting part of this statement is the converse direction. So if X is equal to Y, then certainly P of X holds if and only if P of Y holds, but the converse is the interesting thing. In any case, I'm admitting both of these are true. So, but some other things that are usually thought of as primitive ideas associated to equality are something called symmetry and transitivity. And the reason that those weren't listed as axioms is these ones do follow, as perhaps reflexivity does. So from our basic assumptions that anything is equal to itself and that two things are equal if and only if they have exactly the same properties, we can prove, for instance, the symmetry of equality. So if X is equal to Y, then Y is equal to X. And here's how the proof would go. So we're trying to prove an if-then statement. So you can start by assuming that X equals Y is true. But then by indiscernibility of identicals, it means that X and Y must have exactly the same properties. And so by reflexivity, we know that X is equal to X. And therefore, we must also have that Y is equal to X. Because X equals X is a property of X. And so if Y has all the same properties as X, then Y must equal X as well. And the proof of transitivity is similar. So the statement of transitivity says that if X is equal to Y and Y is equal to Z, then X is equal to Z. And to prove this, we could assume that X and Y are equal. So it follows by indiscernibility that identicals that X and Y must have exactly the same property. And in particular, then if Y has the property of being equal to Z, then X is equal to Z. So that's kind of the sense in which this indiscernibility of identicals are used. I think of it, what I like about these two axioms is, I think they make a lot of sense. So, you know, whatever equals should mean, it should be a reflexive notion. And, you know, what is the use of equality if, you know, things that are equal can be distinguished somehow by having different properties. So that, you know, that's kind of the philosophy behind this primitive notion on equality. So the problem with it, I mean, what's wonderful about it is both the axioms I won't argue about, but it's kind of insufficiently flexible. So there are things in the mathematical universe that I would argue are deserving of the same name, but are not equal. So so this slide is meant to illustrate some examples. So the first is it's a photograph of a painting that's in my office and it's got these kind of 20 hand-drawn circles. And what I love about it is if you look at them, it's very clear that, you know, they're all a little bit different. If you got a geometer out here measuring, you'd see that the curvature is a little bit off and the thickness is a little bit off, and, you know, they're not quite the same size, but they all look perfect to me, you know. So, you know, mathematicians have this idea in their head of the perfect circle, and that's not something that exists in a vault in Paris somewhere. You know, there's no sort of definite size of the perfect circle, but it's just this kind of abstract idea of a space that's one-dimensional and compact and bounded, and, you know, has some other properties that make it into a circle as opposed into something else. So, you know, these circles are not equal because maybe one has radius 2 and the other has radius 2.001, but there's a sense in which they're the same nevertheless. And then there's this very famous sort of joke in topology, which is one area of mathematics, that you know, a topologist is somebody who can't distinguish between a coffee mug and their donut. And what that refers to is that if your donut were made of clay and you sort of kind of push your thumb in it a bit, kind of deform it as indicated here from right to left, you end up with a shape that looks like a coffee mug. And there's a technical name for that deformation. So this is a homeomorphism. I'm thinking of these as both three-dimensional spaces, and they're homeomorphic, meaning there's a continuous bijective function from one to the other and from the other to one. Continuous means it respects nearness, so we're not allowed to sort of tear the donut apart and mash it up in a ball and then make a coffee mug in a completely unrelated way. And so two topologists, two spaces that are homeomorphic are certainly the same in a very strong sense, but they're not equal. I mean, they're definitely not equal in the sense of the traditional logical notion of equality. So these examples are kind of nice because they're visual, but they're not quite prototypical. So I want to try and illustrate an example that's more prototypical to the sorts of mathematical objects that mathematicians actually spend a lot of time thinking about. And so what I'm going to describe are symmetry, or really symmetry groups. So any object has its associated symmetries. What you should think of as a symmetry is that would be a move that would take the object and sort of, I don't know, spin it around, flip it around, do something, and then kind of put it back, so that in a sense it's back in the same place, though it's perhaps been rotated or spun or something like this. So the technical term is something called a group, but a group just refers to a collection of symmetries of some fixed object. So here's an example. So we can think about the symmetries of a twin mattress. So a twin mattress in particular is not square. And you know, what sort of moves can you make on a mattress that leaves it back in the same place? So, I mean, a sort of trivial move is the identity move, where you just sort of leave the mattress where it is. That's a move where nothing moved, but that counts as a move. There's the rotation. So if you sort of keep the top along the top, but swap the head and the tail, that's a move you could make. And I mean, you've moved the mattress in this case, but that's what counts as a symmetry, because if you walked in the room after the fact and your mattress isn't stained or weird or something, you wouldn't be able to tell that it had moved, you know. Then there's the flip. So here I'm keeping the head and the tail at the same end, but I'm swapping the top and the bottom. And then there's something called a flip rotate. Well, it's just the combination of those two moves. So unusually for mattresses, you could perform the flip and the rotate in either order, and the result is the same. But in any case, what this move is it's one that both swaps the head and the tail and the top and the bottom. And you can think that there are no other symmetries. So this is a complete description of all the symmetries. What makes it a group is there's, you know, we're not just counting the different moves that you can make, but you can compose them. You can think about what happens if you first flip and then rotate, or first flip and then flip rotate, or do two rotations in a row. And a complete description of all of that structure describes the symmetry group of the mattress. It's the Klein-Fohr group, in case you've heard about it. Sort of a fun fact is that it does not have a generator, meaning that if you want to actually rotate your mattress and go through all possible configurations, you have to remember which move you did previously, because otherwise you might just undo that move, and there's no sort of uniform way to rotate your mattress. Okay, but now I'm gonna talk about a completely unrelated object, which is t-shirt. And we can think again about symmetries of a t-shirt. So there's the identity symmetry, where you just keep your t-shirt on. There's a rotation where you pull it out around your neck, just rotate it around, and then put the right arm through the left armhole and the left arm through the right armhole. There's a flip, where what I'm gonna do is take the shirt off turn it inside out, and then put it back through the same direction. So the right arm goes back through the right armhole, the left arm goes back through the left armhole. In this case, the front of the shirt is actually on the back now and also sort of inside out. And then there's a flip rotate where I similarly flip it inside out, but now I put the right armhole through the left armhole and the left armhole through the right armhole, which keeps it in front. And there's a very profound sense, again, where these, I mean, the t-shirt has nothing to do with the mattress, but there's a profound sense in which the symmetry groups are the same. I mean, one basic observation is there are four elements of each symmetry group. A more interesting observation is you can sort of match up the elements, which we've done already in these figures, by labeling two of them as identity, two of them as flip, two of them as rotate, two of them as flip rotate. And then most importantly, that one-to-one correspondence respects the composition structure. So there are rules that say that if you perform a flip rotate and then you perform a flip, that's the same as a rotation, and those rules are respected in both of these groups. So they're both the same somehow, but again, they're not equal. One is the symmetries of a mattress and the other is the symmetries of a t-shirt, but they should be equal, and so all mathematicians would consider them equal. And that's where the notion of isomorphism comes in. So it's a more flexible notion of sameness that is meant to accommodate the sorts of examples that we've just discussed. Let's see how this works. So first, the etymological roots, I think, are interesting. So isomorphism comes from the Greek, isomorphic, sort of same and shape. So the argument is that some different things, different mathematical things, deserve the same name because they have the same shape. But again, you know, mathematicians don't really track in metaphor. We would like to have a precise technical meaning of this term, isomorphism, so that everybody agrees exactly what it is. So there's you know, we want a unified language that will describe what it means for two things to have the same shape, no matter what kind of objects they are. So these groups of symmetries are rather different than the topological spaces, and we'd like a common notion of isomorphism that could apply equally in those different contexts. And that's what category theory is for. So category theory is a new area of mathematics that came out in the 1940s, or I guess for mathematicians, we call that new because all the theorems proven 2000 years ago are still true. So 1940s, that's recent history. And what it is it's meant to be kind of a metamathematical language that will allow you to reason about, prove theorems about objects that can have any sort of type without specifying whether they're geometric sort of objects or algebraic sort of objects or analytic sort of objects. So Barry Mazur has a nice metaphor. He says that category is a frames a template for mathematical theory. It should have nouns, the objects, and verbs, the transformations between them, depicted as arrows. So what is a category? So it's something that has a collection of objects. So I'm writing them A, B, and C just so we can think about them, but they can be whatever. These could be sets, these could be spaces, these could be vector spaces, these could be Hilbert spaces, manifolds, or really just abstract objects. They don't have to be sort of sets with structure either. Then there's a primitive notion of arrow between objects. And when you have an arrow, it has a well-defined source and a target. So it's instructive to think of arrows as something like functions, but they don't have to be functions necessarily. We'll see later that a matrix could be regarded as an arrow where its source is the number of rows and its target is the number of columns, for instance. And then what makes, so far I've defined a directed graph, if you're familiar with that notion, but what makes it a category is that there's a composition for these arrows. So if I have a pair of composable arrows, and what that refers to is an arrow F whose target object B is equal to the source object of another arrow G. So if I have, you know, kind of a directed path formed by arrows, then there is a specified composite arrow. And we write G composed F because then if you put in an argument, it would appear on the side that it usually does. And then there's some rules about that composition. So the other is that each object has a reflexivity arrow. This is not the usual name this is given, by the way, but it's, for me, it's more precisely analogous with reflexivity than anything else. So I'm calling it the reflexivity arrow today. And then the composition operation is associative and unital, meaning that there's a well-defined composite of F and G and H, for instance, and in composition with reflexivity acts trivially. So Okay, so this is sort of a very, very general definition that you could then specialize into many different mathematical contexts. So there are, you know, categories of sets and functions, categories of spaces and continuous maps, categories of vector spaces and linear maps, and then other categories that are more abstract. Groups are both the objects of a category, and each group individually can be regarded as a category. So it's a really pretty flexible definition. And one advantage of this flexibility is it allows us to define isomorphism once and for all in a way that'll specialize to cover all of the examples I've mentioned. So, so category again is this thing with the objects and the arrows, and it's meaningful as long as A and B are both objects in the same category and not in different categories, in unrelated categories. As long as A and B belong to the same category, I will say that they are isomorphic if there exists an arrow F that goes from A to B and another arrow G that goes from B to A, so that when I compose those arrows around, so the composite of F followed by G is an arrow from A to A, and the axiom is that that is equal to the reflexivity arrow as opposed to being a different arrow. And similarly, the composite of G followed by F, that's an arrow from B to B, and the axiom is that that is equal to the reflexivity arrow as opposed to being some other unrelated arrow. So this is the notion of isomorphism. That's what it looks like symbolically. Yes.
Ref A, the reflexivity arrow, as something is a sort of analogous of the inverse.
Yes.
Or the inverse element of a.
Yes, group. Absolutely. So once you prove that a particular arrow F has a two-sided inverse G, then it follows that that's unique, and it would be natural notation to write it as F inverse, perhaps. But that kind of privileges the F over the G, and there's sort of no reason to prefer one of the arrows to the other, but absolutely. So the idea here, you know, in the category of sets and functions, an isomorphism would be given by a bijective function necessarily. That's something you could prove together with its inverse function. So similarly for spaces, these would then be continuous homeomorphisms. For groups, they're just called isomorphisms. In many contexts, they're called isomorphisms. Yes.
So I'm a little bit confused. Are the objects in the case where we're thinking about group isomorphisms, to carry on with your example, are sure. the objects elements of the group, or are the objects groups?
Great, that's a great question. So to cover the group example, I would be working in the category whose objects are groups. So each object is an entire collection of symmetries of something or other. And then the morphisms between them are something called group homomorphisms. The arrows between them are something called group homomorphisms. So all of the symmetries of the mattress would be one of these objects A, and all of the symmetries of the t-shirt would be another object B. And the statement that they are isomorphic is that it's possible to define arrows between them with the property that there are arrows in the category. That's what's gonna make them preserve this composition structure that I was emphasizing. And then there are inverses in the sense that their composites are equal to these reflexivity arrows.
But I'm a little bit confused. Doesn't that just mean that there's a bijection between A and B? It's got nothing to do with group inverse elements. A and B are both objects with no finer structure within them.
Right. So in the category of groups, not all functions are regarded as arrows. The only functions that are included in the category of groups are those group homomorphisms. And those are the functions that respect the group composition operation. They'll preserve composition, preserve inverses, preserve identities. So it is stronger than being a mere bijection because we're interpreting this notion of isomorphism in the category of groups as opposed to in the category of sets.
I see. So you would say that A and B, two different groups, are, that seems to be a special case of this definition of isomorphic here.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so and that's the point that I'm trying to make.
Okay.
Yeah, so any notion of isomorphism that you would stumble across in like an undergraduate mathematics course is a special case of this common notion. So, you know, we don't often teach undergraduates the language of category theory. Instead, we'll teach them how to recognize when vector spaces are isomorphic and when groups are isomorphic and when topological spaces are isomorphic, though you call it homeomorphic in that context. But it's all this notion. This common definition is all of those definitions.
Okay, so it's got to be special kinds of arrows, not just any arrows. There's arrows within some set of allowed arrows.
That's okay. Right. So in defining a category, you would say both what the objects are and what the arrows are. And
I see.
And it should be the category that gives the template of the theory. So the theory of groups, I mean, this is Emmy Noether's point of view on groups, is that you can't think of groups as in things in their eyes. I mean, she's a hero to us, not just to the physicists, right? I mean, for all of her theorems about group theory. So, you know, previously these groups of symmetries were thought about as in isolation, and maybe there was this vague notion of isomorphism between groups. But what she really emphasized is how powerful it is to think about these homomorphisms between groups. In other words, the arrows in this theory that are not arbitrary functions, because those would be irrelevant for the theory of groups, but the ones that respect the group structure.
So. I was just going to say that when you say the arrows that you're allowed, they're roughly speaking in any one of these categories, the ones that are compatible with whatever structure you have within.
Yes. That's right. Yeah. Great. Other questions? What did you?
You answer, but I was just going to ask what made it different from a bijection.
Great, awesome, cool.
And okay. does this mean I do not have to remember the difference between isomorphism and homeomorphism and homomorphisms anymore?
Yes, yeah, exactly. Right, I mean, category theory is great for, you know, mathematicians with poor memory. So, cool, so I wanna make a little bit of digression about why I really think that isomorphism is somehow so much richer than equality. So this has nothing to do with the rest of the talk, but it's something that I like, so I'm gonna take a quick detour. So I want to think about the question. So 2, 3, 4 here are just natural numbers, you know, nothing fancy. You know, why is 2 times 3 plus 4 equal to 2 times 3 plus 2 times 4? You know, and what even are 2, 3, and 4? You know, what do these notions even mean after all? So so the technical definition of a natural number in mathematics is as isomorphism class of finite sets, I guess. So the way that these numbers are defined formally is, you know, 2 is represented by any set with 2 elements. And so here I've written A is the name of a set that has 2 elements, a star and an asterisk. And so that's a representative for the number 2. And any other set with 2 elements could have equally been a representative for the other 2, for the number 2. So 2, that's what I mean by saying it's an equivalence class of, or it's in sort of isomorphism class of sets with it. Refers to is it can be represented by any 2-element set, and any other 2-element set would have equally well represented it. Okay, so we should think of 2 again as some sort of code for a 2-element set. Here I've specified a 3-element set with 3 elements and a 4-element set, and this is going to allow us to think about these numbers 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so we also need to define plus and times, and plus and times can be reflected by, and can be defined really in terms of operations on sets. So there's an operation called the disjoint union, which would take 2 sets like the B and C here and just stick them together to form a new set. This is not the union, if you're familiar with the union. In a disjoint union, you sort of know which elements came from B and which elements came from C. And a thing that you'll observe about the disjoint union is the cardinality is bad. So if I take the disjoint union of a 3-element set and a 4-element set, I get a 7-element set. So that's the sense in which this categorifies, or this represents addition. And there's another operation called Cartesian product. And how it's defined is if I take the Cartesian product of a set A with a set B, the elements of this Cartesian product are ordered pairs where the first coordinate comes from A and the second coordinate comes from B. So if you're familiar with R2 or R3 or Rn, those are Cartesian products of the set R with itself. That's the formal definition. And so here, and you can observe that cardinalities then multiply. So if you take a 2-element set and a 3-element set and form the Cartesian product, you can sort of arrange the elements in a little grid and you see that it's a 2 by 3-element set. Okay, so with these operations in mind, I can think about a set that represents the cardinality 2 times 3 plus 4. And how would I form it? Well, firstly, I would take a disjoint union of a 3-element set with a 4-element set. So I have the 7-element set that we have there. And then I'm going to take the Cartesian product of that 7-element set with the 2-element set. I see here's my 2 by 4 or 2 by 7. That's my 14-element set on the left. Similarly, I could represent the cardinality 2 times 3 plus 2 times 4 by taking my 2-element set and forming its Cartesian product with a three element set and with a four element set. So that's sort of on the kind of right bottom here and the right here. And then I take the disjoint union of those and I've now added six elements with eight elements and I have again a 14 element set. So the fact that there's an isomorphism between these two sets is a proof of the equation above. So the presence of an isomorphism means those cardinalities are equal. That's how we define a natural number, is a natural number represents an isomorphism class of sets. So because there is an isomorphism between these two sets, that's a proof, if you will, of the distributivity of multiplication over addition for natural numbers. But what I find particularly interesting about this is, you know, there are 14 factorial isomorphisms between the set on the left and the set on the right. So that's like 80 something billion. It's a whole lot, but we're all thinking of the same one. There's sort of one natural isomorphism. Natural is a technical term in category theory between the left-hand side and the right-hand side, which gives me to, well, to me says that there's some sort of deeper structural thing going on here. You know, we just didn't, everybody in this room is thinking of the same isomorphism between the left-hand set and the right-hand set, but statistically that seems unlikely, right? So, yeah.
You mean the one that sends the same element to the same element?
Yeah, exactly. It's the natural one. It's the natural one. Yeah. I mean, now somebody's going to think of a different one, but that wasn't, you know, you weren't before. Okay. So isomorphism is wonderful in that, you know, for the sorts of mathematical objects that you would meet as an undergraduate, it's the correct notion of sameness. So for spaces, for manifolds, for vector spaces, for Hilbert spaces, et cetera, for groups, for sets. But again, it's not flexible enough for the objects that mathematicians really study. So here's some more kind of geometric topological examples. So we can think about a pair of pants as on the left. So that's a space that topologists think about a lot. You know, it has these three circular boundaries. There's the waistband and the two leg openings, and then it's sort of a sheet of fabric stretched between them in this kind of interesting way. And now what I want you to imagine is you put your pair of pants in the dryer on like really, really, really high heat, and they just shrink all the way up, you know, not just so that you have boy shorts, but like so that it's kind of a one-dimensional string around the back. So you've shrunk your pair of pants into a thong. And when you move from the two dimensions to the one dimensions, that's not a homeomorphism anymore. So it's not an isomorphism in the sense that we previously discussed, but somehow it does preserve the fundamental, maybe homotopical structure of the space, and that, you know, you still have your two holes for the legs. It's the same kind of garment somehow. Definitely not the same. You know, one has some two-dimensional and one has a one-dimensional thing. I changed the color too. That's poor slides. Okay, so another example like that. So now what I want you to imagine is a sort of two-dimensional solid disk. And we're going to shrink the disk a bit and then shrink the disk a bit more. So, you know, as I'm shrinking, you know, those, you know, the two disks that are on the left are homeomorphic to each other. So again, they're isomorphic in the sense of the previous notion of sameness, but I want to continue this process infinitely. So I've shrunk it down infinitely small. So what I have at the end is a single point. So there's a single point and there's these two-dimensional disks, and those spaces are not isomorphic anymore. I mean, if you ask how many points this one has, it's uncountably infinitely many. And if you ask how many points that one has, it's one. So that's a point of difference. But there's also a profound sense in which they're the same. So this disk is an instance of what's called a contractible space, which means, you know, in this sort of homotopical sense, which I'm not really describing, it sort of has nothing going on. You know, any two points in that space can be connected, and any two paths between those spaces can also be connected, and any two surfaces in that space can be connected. So the two-dimensional disk and the point are equivalent in some sense, or the same in some sense. And what's really cool about this example is now pretend that picture is not a two-dimensional disk, but a three-dimensional solid ball. It works exactly the same way. We can take a three-dimensional solid ball and shrink it a bit and shrink it a bit and shrink it a bit and collapse it all the way down to a point. And indeed, this three-dimensional solid ball is also a contractible space, so the same in some sense as the point. And then by transitivity of sameness, the three-dimensional solid ball and the two-dimensional solid disk are the same in some sense. And that works for any dimension, even infinite dimensions. So those examples are not covered by isomorphism. So I like those examples. Yes. Yeah.
Sorry. So it seems that the notion of sameness depends on the things that I'm interested about. Or the level at which I'm interested about things. So, you know, you have two notions of sameness, that are not the same.
Right. That's true. So different from different points of view, you might differ.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, if, for example, I don't care about anything, then everything is the same as everything else.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that's fair. I'll revisit that point in a moment. Great. So I like these examples because they're visual. We can kind of imagine that we understand them. They're, again, not quite prototypical. So I'm going to try and give an example of a prototypical thing that mathematicians would think about that are the same, but not not isomorphic. So I defined a category for you. It was this thing with objects and arrows and composition and reflexivity arrows and so on. And now that I've given a mathematical definition for this term of category, it becomes an object in the mathematical universe. So by giving it a definition, it now exists in the mathematical universe. So it's meaningful to ask whether two categories are the same, you know, because they're objects like anything else. And indeed, there's a notion of isomorphism between categories, which is the definition we gave already. So categories themselves are objects in some larger category. If you'd like to ask me afterwards how that works, I'd be happy to explain. And so it is meaningful to ask whether two categories are isomorphic or not. The fundamental theorem of Galois theory can be understood as an isomorphism of categories, for instance. However, it's not a flexible enough notion of sameness. So to give an example, there's a category whose objects are all finite sets and whose morphisms are only the isomorphisms between them, so only these bijections between them. If you compose bijections, you get bijections, so that's a category. So it's a huge category. There's more than a set's worth of objects. It's just impossible to think about how large that category is. But there's a sense in which it's also very redundant, because now I'm going to describe a different category. So this second category, I called it the category of natural numbers. There is one object for every natural number, and that's it. So in the first category, I don't even know how many objects there are because it's, you know, more than set theory allows you to reason about. In the second category, there's exactly countably infinitely many. There's an object zero, there's an object one, there's an object two, object three, those are all the objects. And now I need to say what the arrows are. And in this category, there's only ever going to be an arrow from n to n. So there's no arrows that go between different natural numbers. And I'll have one arrow from n to n for every element of the symmetric group on n things, so every permutation of n people. So if you have a set of n elements, you can, you know, sort of an ordered set of n elements, you can kind of mix it up. And I'll have, so there will be n factorial arrows from n to n, all of the symmetries of an n element set. So,
sorry, that lost me there. If the thing is really just a number like 8, how can there be different maps from 8 to 8?
Right. Because the definition of a category doesn't require you to do anything different. So for something to be a category, I need to tell you what the objects are and tell you what the arrows are, and I can tell you whatever I want.
Okay.
you know, so I can specify an arbitrary directed graph. So if I want to have 10 different arrows from one object to itself, there's no reason not to. That's not prohibited. And then I need to explain how composition works and unit and the reflexivity arrows and check associativity. And as soon as I've done that, I've got a category.
So even if the thing that you're going from and to is the same, there can be different rules for composing the arrows, and that's where the structure is learning.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And different names for the arrows. I mean, you know, you'll notice I labeled the arrow F because there might be some other arrow H, you know. So actually, while I'm on this slide, I'm going to tell you about another category that I'll think about in a second. So this is a different category whose objects are natural numbers. So the objects are probably, well, I do technically need, so 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, et cetera. And then an arrow from 3 to 4 in this other category, I'm calling it the category of matrices, is a 4x3 matrix with real coefficients, or substitute your favorite field.
Yeah, I'm sorry, just a clarification.
Sure.
I mean, when I learn about what is a function, you learn it's a turn between two sets, domain, codomain, and a relation. In category theory, it's not anymore a turn. It's something that connects A to B, but there are many things that connect each, let's call point of A to each point of B.
Yes.
Right, okay.
So in specifying a category, you need to say what the objects are and what the arrows are, but as long as that has the structure of composition and satisfies these axioms, it's a category. So there are a lot more categories than you were thinking about previously.
And the corollary is, if I have an arrow that goes from each point of A to each point of B, and I have a second arrow that goes from each point of A to each point of B, this will be two different arrows.
Yes, but the objects don't necessarily have points.
So yeah,
it's even more abstract than that, but yes, that's right.
Elements of an object?
Well, not necessarily. So.
And how would you call it?
I wouldn't permit myself to use that language. There is a notion of generalized element, but that's unrelated. So,
okay, fine.
But I mean, the point, if I understood what your previous comment was, you could have a category where there was just one object and a billion arrows.
Absolutely.
And just a long list of rules for how to compose the arrows.
Absolutely.
And that's a very fun category.
And an example of that is take your favorite group. So let's take a really big group, you know, the orthogonal group on, you know, Rn or something like that. That's one object category. So it has one object. We won't even bother to give it a name because who cares? And then each element of the orthogonal group, each sort of n by n matrix, will be an arrow from that object to itself. And the group operation is composition. And so that's a category. It's a very useful category. It's a sense it's like the delooping of the group. But yeah. So in any case, I was trying to describe to you a category called the category of matrices. So the objects are natural numbers, and a morphism from the number n to the number m is an m by n matrix. So now I've told you what the objects and arrows are. What makes it a category is we need a way to compose. So if I had an arrow from n to m, that's an n by n matrix, and an arrow from m to k, that's a k by n matrix. I need a way to compose those and get a k by n matrix. Any suggestions?
Matrix multiplication.
Matrix multiplication, sure enough. So does that have a reflexivity arrow? So I would need an arrow from n to n that's sort of trivial for composition. What is it?
The identity matrix.
The identity matrix, indeed. And it's associative and unital, so it's a category. So what's cool about that category, this category of matrices, sorry, I got way ahead of myself, is that, it's one of the standard approaches to linear algebra in a sense. I mean, you can teach these linear algebra courses where you learn about matrices and all of these matrix operations. But there are other linear algebra courses that have a bit of a different flavor. You talk about this notion of vector space and a linear transformation between them. And somehow they're the same subject. You know, things you can do for matrices, you can express in terms of linear transformations and vice versa. And a reason for that is there's a very close relationship between this category of matrices that I've just defined and the category of vector spaces and linear maps between them. And the relationship between those categories and between those categories and again between these spaces is that they're all equivalent. So that's the notion of equivalence. So there's a similarity between the way we're going to give a precise definition of equivalence and the way we give a precise definition of an isomorphism. So I could define isomorphism between any two objects in any category. It's meaningful to define an equivalence between any two objects that belong to what's called a two category. So it's a two-dimensional category. So I haven't given you a full definition of a two category here, but what it has is its objects and arrows, just like before, except I'm calling them one arrows now. And you can compose the one arrows and you have the reflexivity one arrows, that part's exactly the same. But whenever I have a parallel pair of one arrows, so like this F and this K, they both go from A to B, it's meaningful to have a two arrow between them. And this two arrow will have a source and target. So alpha here has F as its source and K as its target. And then there's composition for two arrows. That's a little bit more complicated to describe, so I'm going to skip it. And that's the notion of a two category. So there's a two-dimensional category. And we can say that objects A and B inside the same two-dimensional category are equivalent just when there exists a pair of one arrows. So this F and G, one goes from A to B, the other goes from B to A. Here, I really would not call G F inverse. That would be incorrect. This is a looser notion of sameness. And then rather than demand that the composites G compose F and F compose G are equal to the reflexivity arrows, I'm going to demand that there are some two-dimensional arrows, so an alpha and a beta, relating the composite G composed F to the reflexivity arrow and relating the composite F composed G to the reflexivity arrow. And so that alpha and beta are isomorphisms. So alpha and beta are arrows in a one category, so it makes sense to ask if they're isomorphisms. So here I'm defining the notion of equivalence in terms of the notion of isomorphism. You'll note actually we define the notion of isomorphism in terms of the notion of equality, because in the definition of isomorphism, we asked that G composed F was equal to the reflexivity arrow at A and F composed E was equal to. Here instead, I'm asking that they're isomorphic. And this really is isomorphic in the sense that we defined previously. So G composed F and REFL at A are two names for objects in some category, and they are isomorphic in that category. So it really is the same notion of isomorphism, though I certainly haven't explained that for you. Okay, and again, this notion of equivalence covers all the cases that I mentioned previously. So there's a two category of categories, and in that two category, the two different perspectives on finite sets are equivalent, and the two perspectives on linear algebra are equivalent. So the category of matrices is equivalent to the category of vector spaces. And the spaces are equivalent. So there's a two category of topological spaces, continuous functions, and homotopy classes of homotopies between them. And homotopy equivalent spaces are equivalent in there. And that covered all of the geometric examples. So the point is equivalent to any Euclidean space in any dimension. So equivalence is all over the place in mathematics today. If you look at the mathematics literature, you know, theorem statement is that something X is equivalent to something Y. You know, it's a very standard notion of sameness between mathematical objects, but there's some deficiencies with it, I guess, from a maybe philosophical point of view or an aesthetic point of view. One problem is that this kind of doesn't stop here. So now that I've defined for you what a two category is, you could ask, when are a pair of two categories, when are they the same? And the best notion of sameness is not an equivalence in the sense that we've defined it, but rather in a sense that requires the notion of a three category. So two categories really live as objects inside a three-dimensional category, and so we need an even more flexible notion of sameness there. But now that three categories are objects, they live somewhere, they live in a four category, their notion of sameness is expressed there, and it gets sort of more and more complicated. So there's this, this is related to the second point. So there's no longer a single meaning of when one thing is the same as any other thing. So this is related to Andre's objection, though I wasn't thinking that I don't care what anything is and so everything's the same, but more different objects, you know, can belong in sort of different levels of complexity of category. So if you're thinking of your spaces as living in a one category, then your notion of sameness is homeomorphism. If you're thinking of them as living in a two category, then your notion of sameness is homotopy equivalence, for instance. And this step sort of definitely comes up. And then finally, you know, somehow this is something that people don't think about so much, but is in a sense, a pretty serious issue, is that indiscernibility of identicals. So this is one of the key axioms. In fact, in a sense, the key axiom for equality is no longer holds for objects that are isomorphic or equivalent, but not equal. So we saw some spaces that are equivalent that have different numbers of points. So that's a property, you know, the single point space, the property of it is it has just one point. Whereas the disk, a property of it is that it has uncountably infinitely many points. So those things are the same in a sense of equivalence, but they have different properties. And similarly for categories, we had some categories that have countably infinitely many objects and other categories that have not even a set's worth of objects, and somehow they're the same. So, you know, that's really an issue of concern. I'd be happy to talk maybe afterwards about how that gets addressed. But this is all meant to bring me to my final notion of sameness that I think kind of ties everything together and resolves a lot of these problems. And this is called identity and maybe identification. And what's different about this final notion of sameness is it's going to be made formal in a different foundation system for mathematics than the traditional one. But that sounds a little scary, but you know, a fun parlor game is to ask mathematicians what the axioms for, so it's the traditional notion of foundation for mathematics is set theory, and it's sort of fun parlor game is to ask mathematician to name any of the axioms in set theory, and you know, most working mathematicians don't know. So there's a sense in which maybe you could change this foundation system and it, you know, people wouldn't notice. I mean, that's, I don't actually believe that, but in any case, this is a different foundation system. So how does it work? So it's something called type theory. It's as old as set theory. It was one of the proposed foundation systems. And I guess I wish it had won, but maybe it's making a resurgence. So so in type theory, the primitive notion is something called a type and a term. And what types are for are making mathematical assertions. So a mathematical sentence, we kind of previously sketched how those could be written in this language called first order logic. Now that's encoded by some type. So there's a type that encodes a statement. This is sometimes gets called propositions as types. And then a term in that type provides a proof of that encoded statement. So that's sort of one way to think about type theory. It's not the only way to think about type theory, but maybe it'll do for now. Any case, we have these primitive notions of type and term. You can think of them vaguely as set and element, but they're more flexible than that. So the way that identity is introduced into type theories in terms of something called identity types, and I'm going to tell you these rules. So these are due to Permar and Leuf in the 1970s, and there are three of them, well, secretly four, but I've left the fourth one out. What are they? So the first one says that for any type A, so A you can also just think of as like a type of mathematical things. It could be like a type of groups or type of spaces or the type of natural numbers. And any terms that belong to the same type, so X and Y here are both terms in the type A, then there is a type X equals Y. So the way that I would think of this is it's like a no-nonsense statement. It's only meaningful to identify things that belong to the same type. So there will never be an identification between an X and a Y if they don't already be, if they aren't already the same type of thing. So this is a more restrictive, it's a restriction on when it's even meaningful to ask whether two things are the same. We're saying two things could be the same if they're the same sort of thing. You know, so it's not meaningful to say that, you know, a group is the same as a space because groups and spaces are just different things. Okay, so the second rule is reflexivity. So it says for any type and any term in that type, there is a term called REFL X that inhabits the type X equals X. So remember, we're thinking of a term and a type as a proof of the statement. So this REFL X is a particular proof that the reflexivity property holds. So this term REFL X is proving that X equals X is true. So I'm allowed to form the type X equals Y for any X and Y belonging to the same type and may or may not have any terms. And if it doesn't have terms, that's means that it's just not the case that X and Y can be identified. But here, so the second axiom is saying that there's always a proof that X is equal to X. We're calling this proof reflexivity because it's proving the reflexivity property. Okay, so the final axiom is quite complicated. It's the analog for identity types of the principle of mathematical induction for natural numbers. And so if you remember how complicated that is, that's why this is complicated, but it's somehow no more complicated than that. So in a different talk, I would say a lot more about the analogy between this and mathematical induction. But in any case, what it says is that if I have any type, this capital P, so you should think of this as like a property that's defined using a pair of terms, X, Y of A, and a proof P that X and Y are identified, then if there is a term that proves this property in the case where Y is really X and this P is the reflexivity proof, then you can prove this property for any X, Y, P. Okay, so that's, again, that's quite complicated, but this is the indiscernibility of identicals, or it implies really this indiscernibility of identicals. So two things are identifiable if and only if they have exactly the same properties. And like for equality and first order logic, we do not assert symmetry or transitivity because they can be proven from this third property, this indiscernibility of identicals property. Okay, so far this looks basically like the notion of equality that we had at the very beginning, except it's in a different foundation system. It's in type theory as opposed to in set theory, which means we have this first thing, this restriction that the terms have to belong to the same type. But so far this looks exactly the same as where we started. We sort of circled back to the beginning, which is good in a sense because those axioms were reasonable and now they're back. So what really animates identity types is something called the univalence axiom. This is due to Vladimir Voevodsky, who died unfortunately in 2017. And what it says is it relates the identity types in this universe of all types to equivalences between types. So the slogan for univalence is that it's saying that identity is equivalent to equivalence. What it means formally is that, so A and B are types, we can regard them as terms in this universe of all types, and then ask, we can form this identity type. So it's meaningful to ask, are A and B equal as types? So they're identifiable as types. And this axiom is providing a proof that is equivalent to the notion of equivalence between types, where equivalence between types is defined exactly as we did in the previous section. So it's in terms of having functions between the types so that the composite functions are sort of homotopic to the identity. So this is a very, very, very powerful axiom. When you add an axiom to a formal system, it's always a bit of a risk. You never, you worry that you'll be able to prove false things from your new axiom, but it has been proven that this is at least relatively consistent with traditional foundations of mathematics. So, you know, a thing about mathematics that's a little disconcerting is we don't actually know if it's consistent or not, but if normal mathematics is consistent, this is as well. So it's a reasonable axiom. So Vladimir explained that the term univalent came, in fact, from a mistranslation of this famous book in algebraic topology into Russian, where something that's traditionally called a faithful functor was translated as a univalent functor. So his perspective on this univalence is this is giving a notion of sameness that is faithful to the way I think about mathematical objects in my head. And what exhibits that is the following list of consequences. So we've mentioned various types of mathematical objects that deserve the same name. So two badly drawn circles, I was arguing, ought to be the same. The coffee cup and the donut are arguing to be the same. The pair of pants and the thong, the Euclidean spaces in any dimension, these disks and balls, and the one-point space. The numbers, 2 × 3 + 4 and 2 × 3 + 2 × 4. The groups of symmetries of the mattress and of the t-shirt. Categories of finite sets and natural numbers, the abstract and concrete linear algebra, those were categories as well. So in each of these examples, these things, so the numbers, for instance, are terms belonging to a common type. And as a consequence of the univalence axiom, so something that you could prove from the univalence axiom, it's a theorem that's sometimes called structure identity principle, identifications, that is proofs of identity or terms in these identity types, recover exactly the notions of sameness previously introduced. And what's cool about this is this specializes to the right thing in every context. It specializes to quality between natural numbers, to isomorphism between groups, to equivalence between categories. This single notion of identity really unifies all of the notions of sameness that we've seen previously. So I'll conclude. So we've taken a mathematical journey, sort of a historical journey, from quality through isomorphism to equivalence to identification. And while the traditional, maybe to sum up, so the traditional notion of equality is arguably too narrow in that there are more things that deserve to be given the same name than are equal. Its defining principles are worth preserving. And while the categorical notions of isomorphism and equivalence identify objects that have the same shape or equal worth, they require increasingly higher dimensional data as the objects become more complex. But this type theoretic concept of identification with its rules, the sort of no-nonsense reflexivity and indiscernibility of identicals, in the presence of this univalence axiom, it really does specialize to the correct notions of sameness between objects of any type. That's all I have. So thanks so much.
So I think it's sometimes easy to miss. I mean, this all sounds very abstract, and also they're kind of it's only talking about mathematics, but with type theory, type theory is a notion of computation. Mm-hmm. You could write programs in type theory. And type theory with univalence, I mean, I like to dream of the possibility of formulating a given discipline. Mm-hmm. I mean, say there's chemical reaction networks and petri nets. Mm-hmm. There are two disciplines. They have their, you know, their own approaches and everything, but they are actually equivalent. And so something that I think univalence would give you is a way of systematically transporting, I think is a technical term, a technique from one discipline to another, rather than just saying that they are the same.
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
So the one caveat there, which I think you're aware of, is so one of the advantages of the type theoretic foundations is it's a language that computers speak, and you can interpret mathematical proofs as computer programs, as algorithms. Univalence, as I'm stated, however, is an axiom. And so it kind of destroys, just asserting it as an axiom destroys the computational content of homotopy type theory, which is the sort of type theory system that has this univalence. So if in your proof you call the univalence axiom, then you can't kind of normalize your terms all the way down anymore. So we're working on that. We're working on new type systems that would allow you to prove univalence constructively and then restore the computational property, but it's still under development.
I see.
But yeah, in theory, that's the dream. And I think this part's gonna work out. Yes.
Yes, I have sort of a slightly off topic question. Great. Which is, I'm thinking about sort of folk concepts of equivalence, or at least non-mathematician concepts of equivalence, where most people in society would have no problem calling all of your circles circles and putting those in a category, but they would really dislike the mathematician coffee cup donut topological example. And I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts about what the natural categories of sort of natural learning versus this, which is sort of going in the direction of like finding more and more equivalencies, and why we didn't come to some of those, say, naturally in language or natural learning, or how we use these concepts in our daily life. Is, you know, what's the added bit for natural experience?
Yeah, that's a fair objection. And I mean, all I can speak to is from my personal experience is that after a while, you sort of forget that these things don't exist in the real world, you know. So, you know, we were talking on the board the other day, and I was drawing a bunch of solid disks. And then later I decided I wanted them to be squares, you know, solid squares instead. And like, you know, those spaces are entirely the same to me. And so, you know, you just sort of substitute in one for the other and pretend you were working with the squares all along. And yeah, I don't know, but I mean, that's a very interesting question to think about. And I probably haven't given it a lot of thought, but absolutely Andreas. Objection is, you know, the notion of sameness is certainly context dependent. So there's a difference between geometry, where you would care about sort of angles and measurement, and topology, where you care about sort of, you know, are these points close, are these points far, relatively speaking. We're not necessarily assigning numbers to those concepts. I don't know. I mean, maybe one thing to say though is, you know, there really is like a case to be made for abstraction. I know it makes mathematicians hard to talk to, but it really makes these things a lot easier to understand. So, you know, in many cases, you know, so properties of symmetry, you know, were being studied in the, you know, early 1800s, when, you know, people, or when even before that, people were looking to understand solutions to polynomials equations. And, you know, at some point, you know, if you're thinking about the imaginary number I as a solution to the equation x squared plus 1 equals 0, at some point it was observed that negative I works equally for I in all contexts. You know, there's no way from this algebraic point of view to distinguish between those. And so you're then become interested in a symmetry that would swap I for negative I, complex conjugation, basically. You know, it's a miracle that any, like, you know, Galois or any of these people were able to figure anything out to prove that you know, the insolubility of the quintic equation, the fact that all these classical Greek problems of doubling the cube and squaring the circle and trisecting the angle are impossible, because the way that they were thinking about these objects was so sort of laborious and like bogged down in coordinates and, you know, but once we have this abstract notion of a group, which is not a thing that exists in the real world. I mean, I totally get it. You know, people, you know, what the hell is that? But, you know, once we have this notion, you're just able to think about it so much more clearly. And now, you know, these theorems that people were puzzling about for 2000 years are taught to undergraduates in mathematics departments all over the world, you know? I mean, there is of course a trade-off when you move to these abstractions, you're kind of moving away from the real world. And, you know, maybe if the whole point is to like understand the world we live in, you're kind of off somewhere else, but I don't know.
Well, I should be clear that I think those abstractions are amazingly useful, and topology, as even the example we're talking about, has had all these applications. It's the question is more like, why don't humans see the coffee cup donut transformation as children, or, you know, why is that not sort of the obvious Whereas some of these other ones are really natural, like what creates those distinctions?
Yeah, I don't know. I'd love to know more about that. But
could I ask a question that's kind of related to Chris's question? Speaking as somebody who loves abstract mathematics and has even written stuff related to it, I certainly see the great usefulness in terms of things like group theory, abstract topology theory, precisely in that it allows us to get to a conclusion faster than we would have otherwise, or maybe even where we frankly would not have gotten there otherwise. And I see the appeal of category theory as almost aesthetics. I have trouble seeing it even as philosophy, because I'm not quite sure what philosophical problem it's addressing. And I also have problems seeing it in terms of that character of mathematics that allows me to get to something quicker than I would have if it did not exist.
Sure.
So I've got a question that's actually, I know that this is a question that category theorists get continually, but I'm always left with this scratching my head of saying, I've got a limited time left on planet Earth. What is the benefit to me of learning category theory?
Great. I don't know what else you're interested in, so there may or may not be a benefit to you.
A lot of things.
But, right. So, I mean, the language that, in a sense, I think the strongest case to be made for category theory is that the language that many mathematicians speak today, it would be impossible to even define their basic objects of study without the language of category theory. So we have an algebraic geometer in the room. So I'll pick on, traditionally algebraic geometry was about solutions to polynomial equations. So that you can define without category theory, I'll give you that. But modern algebraic geometry is all about these things called like schemes. And there's no way to even say what that is without the language of category theory. Similarly, topology, it's moved from spaces to spectra. It's hard to say what spectra are. It's hard to say what homotopy theories are without the language of category theory. So.
So you're actually telling me something that's much more concrete than what I had understood. You've said that it's actually so useful that it is now the lingua franca of higher math.
Right. So not in all areas of mathematics. I will certainly not make that case, but in certain areas of mathematics, it's pervasive in that sense.
Okay. So then something practical for me in my remaining half century or whatever. Can you point to a good book or any kind of a source that basically says category theory for people who just want, you know what I'm asking for? Category theory for dummies, in essence. Category theory for people who don't want to become category theorists, who want to understand enough of this language to be able to benefit from it.
Sure. So I'll give you three recommendations. So I've written a book that's for mathematicians, for mathematics students. And it was essentially because I was sick of these like smart aleck grad students saying, you know, there are no theorems in category theory. How is this relevant to the rest of mathematics? So somebody who is, had sort of an undergraduate level mathematics education, I think my book, it's called Category Theory in Context, and it places it within the context of mathematics. So for non-mathematicians, I would not recommend my book at all. There are two alternatives. David Spivak and Brendan Fong have a series of books that are directed at applied science, or scientists really. So one of them I think is called Category Theory for Scientists, and the other is called Seven Sketches in Compositionality. And what's wonderful about both of those books is they really discuss quite a sophisticated category theory without using technical mathematical language. And I think that's really cool. Finally, a friend of mine, Eugenia Chang, has a new book coming out that'll be out this year called The Joy of Abstraction. And in a sense, this one is kind of a more traditional course in category theory. So it'll certainly cover this notion of isomorphism and many other things besides, but it's very gentle. It's not assuming mathematics background. She's a beautiful writer. So that's also a fun read.
Okay, quick question then, and then I'll bow out. So sure. You mentioned Spivak and Fong. What is your opinion of how helpful it would be to actually drill down on John Bias, who is, of course, very, very much promoting category theory. I think Spivet and Fong are both associated with him. And it strikes me that what he's tried to do with it so far hasn't borne fruit. But he does have some stuff that is more foundational. Would you recommend that as well? But given that he's a physicist.
Sure. So, I mean, it depends on what you mean, what you were hoping it would do. I mean, so John Bias has had several very, very important ideas that were inspired by physics that have had a transformative effect on mathematics. So, you know, in fact, the existence of higher category theory as a field, as an area of study, owes a lot to the physicists who are interested in, you know, giving a mathematical definition of a field theory, you know, particularly the kind of topological version of a field theory. What that is essentially is it's an arrow between higher categories. You know, he's super influential on mathematics. I can't speak to his effect on the physics community, but.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right, thank you very much.
Sure.
Yes, yeah, thanks, Emily.